seriously? You got sassed by a Squatch? Are you kidding me? No way. Come on, details. I want the details. No, really, I want all the details. I really do. Put them in an email and send them to me at contact@buckeyebigfoot.com. Welcome back to Buckeye Bigfoot. Are we ready to saddle up and start our journey down deep into Sasquatch Valley? I don't know about you, but I know I am. So go on, grab your snackage. Let's get moving. We've got a long way to go, and it's already pretty dark out there. And you know, with the nights this dark, there are Sasquatches everywhere. My name is Tom, but you can call me Shorty. That's what I've been called all my life. I was born and raised in the Baltimore, Maryland area, and I now live in Berkeley County, West Virginia. This incident happened in the Morgan County, West Virginia area. In 1988, I was married, and it was hard living on the little bit of money that I was making. My dad offered me more money to come up to West Virginia and work, so my wife and I decided that I would go and work with him and my brother. I was leaving Maryland on Monday mornings around 4 a.m. and returning back home on Friday nights. One Monday in late October, we came home, and my mom told us a story that something had happened that day. It was something that at that time we said was a bunch of bull crap, but my mother would not lie. She said that after it had stopped snowing that day, and we had had about 8 inches of snow on the ground, and there was about a half inch of ice on top of that, it was the kind of ice that a big man could walk on. Well, she and my sister-in-law took the kids out to play. They got to the area of their artesian wellhead, and Mom noticed big footprints in the snow. She said the prints had broken through the ice. At that time, I weighed 350 pounds, and I could not break through that ice. The footprints moved down from the top of the yard at the wood line, where they looked to have stopped by the well, then got down on its knees to drink from the artesian well. Then they moved down the hill to the frozen pond, where it looked to have picked out all the duck feed, the corn, out of the frozen mud. They picked out every single piece. The prints then continued down the yard into a little bit of woods and then across the road. Mom believed it was a Bigfoot. My dad and I both said, "That's bull crap." Okay, so my story is in the middle of December of that same year. We got off work early one day, and I decided to go hunting. I got all dressed up in my camo, grabbed my gun, and off I went. Up the hill to the top, it's about a quarter mile or so. After that, I started down the other side. I was facing across the top of the hill, and at about 15 to 20 minutes before dark, something started to come up the hill toward me. At first, I thought it was a big deer, but soon after, it started screaming, and I knew it was not a deer. I was not sure until I noticed the smell. It smelled like rotten feces at the dump on a 100-degree day. It sounded like it was running back and forth, and it was screaming so loud, it was like a bulldozer going through the woods. It's really hard to describe. It's something you just have to go through to understand. I was so scared, I could have crapped myself. I stayed as still as I could, but I was shaking badly. I never saw what it was, though. Before it got too dark, I climbed down out of the tree stand. I don't think my feet touched any of the steps that were nailed up to the tree. When my feet hit the ground, I started running back down the hill to get back to Mom and Dad's house. Mom was out on the back deck, and as soon as she saw me, she asked me what was wrong. I got into the house and sat down at the kitchen table. My dad asked me the same thing. I told them what happened, and my dad said that I was full of, well, you know what. The only person I've ever told this story to in the past 30 years is my wife. I know she believes me, and that's all that matters to me. I'll never ever forget what I heard that day in the woods. Thank you, Shorty. Hi, Nance. I'm going to go ahead and let you take care of the introductions and all of that good stuff because I'm not a radio personality. And just for the record, folks, no, I'm not either. But anyway, we'll continue. He says, I'm a mechanic and I'm 36. When I was about 10, my mom married my stepdad. His great idea was to take her to the deep wilderness in Canada for their honeymoon. In his defense, the fishing and hunting up there is another level of amazing. The resort was called the Flint Wilderness Resort. It's still there, but it's like a 4-hour drive to the nearest, what we would call, gas station. And that's more like an Indian outpost for the natives up there. Anyway, not much help. When my stepdad would go bear hunting with his boss, I would be fishing, though we spent most of the time together. We were up there for 10 days, and after the first day, my mom was basically an all-you-could-eat buffet for the black flies. She got ate up pretty good, so she stayed in a cabin the rest of the time and was pretty much miserable. Anyway, the cabin we stayed in was the owner's brother's cabin, which was the only one with heat and hot water, which is a huge commodity up there. We would usually head out at sunrise and proceed to go slay lots of pike and walleye. We had 2 stringers full of them hanging over the sides of the boat that Dad wanted me to go retrieve the next morning. Across from our cabin was a shack where they had stainless steel counters inside, so you could fillet your fish and then slide the remains out the end through a hole which fed into a 55-gallon drum outside. So we just woke up, and we weren't paying any attention. My stepdad went into the shed to get ready to fillet the fish, while I went to go get them off the boat. What's crazy is, looking back now, my dad must have walked right past it going into the shed, and he didn't even notice it. By the time I went down to the dock and started walking back up with the fish, I didn't notice it at first, either. So, the dock is about 50 or 60 yards from the cabin in the shed. I get about half of that distance back to the shed, and I'm carrying about 50 pounds of fish in each hand. I was only 10, but I'm a pretty stout guy. I was, even by then. Anyway, so I get ready to walk into the shed, and I just happen to look up, and I caught a movement on the side of it where that big drum is full of fish guts. Standing there quietly was a huge creature on 2 legs. I've always been interested in paranormal things, especially cryptids, so I pretty much knew what it was as soon as we locked eyes. So here I am, realizing that I'm no more than, 50 or 60 feet away from this thing, and it's eating the fish remains. And there I am, holding about 100 pounds of fish. So automatically, I assume it's about to come after me for this fish. There was no musky smell. I believe they only release that smell as a defense mechanism. I couldn't smell anything. It was also quiet. It just stood there and it looked at me with its left hand kind of held halfway up to its chest, like it stopped to check me out. So I start to set the fish on the ground, and I begin to pull out my 14-inch bladed Bowie knife. It's bigger than Crocodile Dundee's. And it's that big because we know from past experiences, animals don't fear you up there. I mean, they will walk right up to you. We once had to kill a mountain lion because it was crouched down, ready to attack, and we could not scare it away. We kept honking the horns at it. It just stayed in the middle of the road. So anyway, I'm preparing to fight for my life, or to turn around and run and jump into the nearby freezing water of the lake. But after staring at each other for about a minute or two, it just turned around and quietly walked away. I mean, you couldn't hear a twig break or a leaf crunch or anything. The thing is, you know, on one-story structures, the gutter line is about 9 or 10 feet off the ground. When this thing stood next to the shed, the gutters only came up to about the bottom of its neck, or where its neck should be, but instead of a neck, it had highly developed trapezoidal muscles, like a chimpanzee or something. It wasn't as clean-looking as, like, Harry and the Hendersons, either. It was like that thing's big, ugly uncle or something. But I never really felt threatened or stalked or anything like that. It was just kind of doing its own thing, and I just happened to be there. It must have been pretty darn quiet and blending in with all the surrounding trees, because my dad walked within feet of it and didn't even know it. Anyway, I got the fish into the shed, and I didn't really say anything until a few years later when we came back. But he doesn't believe me, and I really don't care because I've seen a lot of things that people shouldn't see or aren't supposed to. I need to say that I did become a paranormal investigator shortly after that, but that's a story for another time. Thank you for reading my story, and my name is David Sias. I live in London, Ohio, and don't worry, even though the story takes place in Canada, there's plenty going on in Ohio, too. Thanks, Nance. I hope people enjoy this. Please have a wonderful day. All right, well, thanks to Shorty and to David for both of those emails. Now, David, you mentioned that there's a lot more going on in Ohio. Well, you know we want to hear about it. If you've had more moments with the Grassman or things up there in Canada, don't keep them to yourself. You know we all want to hear them. Well, everyone, I know this is a little shorter than usual, but I'm just trying to get us all back into the swing of things. And, you know, it's New Year's Eve. I got places to go, things to do. Well, no, not really. I'm staying home tonight. But anyway, I hope everyone has a safe celebration tonight. Me and Mr. Buckeye Bigfoot are staying in, as I mentioned earlier. You know, we might be able to stay awake long enough to hear the clock strike midnight, but probably not. We rarely do. We'll just wake up tomorrow to 2022. And as for 2022, I thought a little Irish blessing was in order for all of us. You know, the last 2 years, they've been really hard on everyone. So here's hoping that 2022 is a gentle and joyous year for us all of us around the globe. Goodness knows we need it. All right, well, listen, until we meet up again, stay safe, stay healthy, and stay happy. And always remember, absence of proof is not proof of absence. Thanks for listening, everyone.